State Minister for Legal Affairs Damian Gomez resigns from cabinet. Three teens charged with the high-profile murder of another teen. Eight men wanted by the United States on drug charges extradited this morning. And a former police officer charged with a string of armed robberies. We've got those stories and a lot more coming up tonight. I'm Dana Smith, and NB12 starts right now. Happy news tonight. A state minister for legal affairs, Damian Gomez, has tendered his resignation from the cabinet. This after contemplating his departure several times. And while Gomez didn't say much today as to why he resigned, our news team understands it's for financial reasons. Kyle Joaquin has the story.
Gomez didn't say much to reporters today about his resignation, but he did indicate that he will speak further on it tomorrow afternoon after the cabinet meeting. But what he did tell reporters was that although he is resigning from the cabinet, Perry Christie still has his full support.
I support Mr. Christie. I support the Progressive Liberal Party.
That was Central and South Lutheran MP and State Minister for Legal Affairs Damian Gomez's response when asked if he still has faith in the leadership of the Prime Minister, Perry Christie. As a cabinet minister, Gomez earned $60,000 a year. His salary for simply being a member of parliament is $28,000, for a total of $88,000 a year. We attempted to speak with Deputy Prime Minister Philip Davis just after parliament broke today.
Well, I haven't had the opportunity to talk to him about it. I don't know whether that's true or not yet. I'm just still getting the information as you did. When I do, I will.
He has confirmed it, though. He has confirmed it.
I haven't talked to him. He hasn't confirmed it to me yet.
Does this say anything about the strength of the cabinet right now?
No, it doesn't.
Our news team was stopped as we tried to ask Prime Minister Perry Christie about Gomez's resignation. But moments later, Christie confirmed that Gomez did indeed resign because of his pay and said that cabinet ministers deserve more money. Christie said that as the Prime Minister, he isn't unhappy and that the government has an agreement with Gomez. He did, though, refuse to say exactly what that agreement is. But this isn't the first time Gomez considered resigning from cabinet. Earlier this year, Gomez admitted that he contemplated resigning after feeling as though the government had failed to deliver on its many promises. The Prime Minister had reportedly discouraged Gomez's resignation. And just last week, Gomez was highly critical of the government's public relations surrounding national health insurance.
Now, we also caught up with opposition leader Dr. Hubert Minnis, who said he wasn't surprised by Gomez's resignation at all. But he did say that although Gomez previously said that he's not a political prostitute, he is still welcomed within the folds of the FNM.
He's obviously also tired of the empty promises that have been made. And Christie clearly does not represent, nor is he interested in new generation or bridge to the future. I had said repeatedly, and I've said from day one, and my statement still holds, the FNM is an open tent, full stop. That has always been our statement, and that statement remains today.
Regardless, Gomez said he plans on running again in the constituency of Central and South Eleuthera.
Do you plan on running again in your constituency?
If my constituency branch has me, yes.
So you plan on seeking?
Yes. Thank you.
Reporting for NB12, I'm Kyle Joaquin.
Three teens appeared in the magistrate's court this morning, charged with the murder of 16-year-old Adonai Wilson, the Doris Johnson senior high school student whose death last Wednesday shocked the nation. A 15-year-old boy, 16-year-old boy, and 18-year-old young man appeared before Chief Magistrate Joanne Ferguson Pratt, accompanied by their parents. Also appearing before the magistrate this morning, a former police officer who was charged with three counts of armed robbery.
Here you come. Come on the side.
The three teens arrived at court with their faces covered, shackled, and flanked by officers. More police officers, armed with rifles and handguns, swarmed the magistrate's court complex as the accused were led inside. The trio appeared before Magistrate Ferguson Pratt, who ordered the media not to identify any of the accused. The 15-year-old, seen here in the blue shirt, the 16-year-old, seen here in yellow, and the 18-year-old, wearing orange, were all charged with murder. As the charge was read, the 15-year-old wept openly and uncontrollably in court and leaned heavily on his mother. The 16-year-old quietly dabbed at tears with tissue he had in his pocket as his mother and father stood beside him, while the 18-year-old looked down at the floor, somber, as his father briefly laid his hand on his back. The 15-year-old's persistent tears prompted Ferguson Pratt to repeatedly ask him if he was all right and to call for a court official to bring him some tissue. All three teens were charged as juveniles, including the 18-year-old, who recently reached the age of majority this past Friday on December 11th. It is alleged that on Wednesday, December 9th, being concerned together and by means of unlawful harm, the teens did intentionally cause the death of Adonai Wilson. The incident in question took place near Blanco Beach at the intersection of Prince Charles Drive and Fox Hill Road. According to police, it was a fight between students that turned deadly when 16-year-old Adonai, a 12th grade student at Doris Johnson Senior High School, was stabbed and killed. In the aftermath of his death, a graphic video purporting to show the incident was widely circulated on social media. Several officers and senior members of the Royal Bahamas Police Force were present in and outside of the courtroom, prompting Ferguson Pratt to dub their presence a little over the top and excessive. Superintendent B.K. Bonamy explained the heavy police presence was for the security of the people charged. The 15-year-old defendant was represented in court by attorney Roberto Reckley. The 16-year-old was represented by Ian Cargill, while the 18-year-old was represented by Mario DeCille. They were not required to enter a plea to the charge, and the matter will proceed to the Supreme Court by way of a voluntary bill of indictment. At the request of their attorneys, Ferguson Pratt said she would make note that the 15-year-old and 16-year-old be remanded to the Simpson Penn Center for Boys. But ultimately, she said that decision would be up to the head of Simpson Penn. But regretfully, she added, the 18-year-old would have to be remanded to the Bahamas Department of Corrections at Fox Hill. DeCille asked the magistrate to make an exception as the accused was a minor at the time of the incident. He also told the court the victim's father is an officer at the prison. However, Ferguson Pratt said she had no authority to do so, but said she would take note of DeCille's requests and concerns. Before they were led away, Ferguson Pratt gave all three teens a chance to speak with their families. At that point, as they shared hugs with their equally grieving family members, all the teens broke down in tears. They were remanded in custody until their next court appearance on January 28th. Also appearing before Magistrate Ferguson Pratt this afternoon, a former police officer charged with three counts of armed robbery. It is alleged that 23-year-old Codero Emanuel of Golden Isles Road on Friday, December 4th, while armed with a handgun, robbed a woman of her black leather handbag, which contained her wallet, valued at $400, a Bahamian passport, valued at $60, a silver chain, valued at $300, a Samsung cell phone, valued at $150, a Commonwealth Bank ATM card, valued at $20, and a Bahamian driver's license valued at $20. It is further alleged that on that same date and armed with a handgun, Emmanuel robbed another woman of her pink handbag valued at $50, a Bahamian passport valued at $60, an NIB card, a Commonwealth Bank card valued at $10, and a Samsung cell phone valued at $100. And finally, on the same day, and reportedly armed with a handgun, it is alleged Emmanuel robbed a third woman of her tan Kipling bag, valued at $150. Emmanuel was represented in court by attorney Ian Cargill, who adds that his client, as a member of the Royal Bahamas Police Force, be kept out of general populace and housed in a secure part of the prison for his own security. Ferguson Pratt said she would make note of Cargill's request, but added that she's been advised Emmanuel is no longer a police officer. And Senior Assistant Commissioner of Police Stephen Seymour, who was present at Emmanuel's arraignment, confirmed in court that the accused is now a former officer. Emmanuel was not required to enter a plea to the charges. The matter will proceed to the Supreme Court by way of a voluntary bill of indictment. Ferguson Pratt gave him a moment to speak with his fiancée before he was remanded to prison until his next court appearance on January 28th.
Over at the Supreme Court, a jury convicted two of four people accused of the 2013 murder and armed robbery of Kurt McCartney, brother to DNA leader Branville McCartney. After 3 hours of deliberations, the 12-member jury convicted Thorne Edwards of McCartney's murder and armed robbery. Prosecutors are seeking the death penalty for Edwards. Lindira Curry, the mother of his son, was found not guilty of murder, but convicted of manslaughter and armed robbery. Jurors acquitted O'Kell Farrington and Sumya Ingram of the charges. An anonymous witness claimed that Edwards shot McCartney in the head at Gambier Village when Curry signaled to him as she argued with McCartney. The anonymous witness testified that Curry, Ingram, and Farrington got into McCartney's Hummer after he fell to the ground and rolled over him with the vehicle as they fled towards West Bay Street. Senior Justice Stephen Isaacs will hold a sentencing hearing on February 29th. A group of men wanted by the United States to face drug charges was extradited today, according to a police source who told the NASA Guardian that 8 of the 11 wanted men were flown out. The source identified the men as Melvin Maycock Sr., Brian Deal, Carl Colmer, Lyndon Deal, Sheldon Moore, Gordon Newbold, Wilfred Ferguson, and Tori Lockhart. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs released a statement this afternoon and confirmed the names of those Bahamian men. They were escorted to Odyssey International Airport by local police, where they were handed over to U.S. federal authorities who took them to the U.S. on waiting planes.